everyone, welcome to MindBrain Talks, the place where you find diverse and scientifically accurate information regarding psychology, neuropsychology, neurosciences and research methods every single week. My name is Bruno Faustino, I am a licensed clinical psychologist and neuropsychologist who's been working as a therapist, researcher and educator for the past few years. Here, in MindBrain Talks, I discuss and describe lots of topics, research findings and concepts from neurosciences to psychology, and I try to explain them the best as I can for you to understand and for you to know something more about it. All research here are just for educational purposes, and it's not intended to diagnose any psychiatric condition or neurological disorder. So, without further delay, let's jump for today's content. Today's theme is related to metacognition. What is metacognition? How can it be applied to different schools of psychology? And how can it be applied in a clinical settings? This is some answers that I'll give to you in this video. This video, it will be framed in the category of concepts and theories. So now let's see what is metacognition. Metacognition is a human ability to be aware, to reflect, to control one's thoughts and internal mental process. Usually we can call this about cognition, thinking about thinking, knowing about knowing, aware of awareness. Typically is viewed as a higher order thinking skills that allows strategic thinking. Also, it can be defined as knowledge about when and how to use particular strategies for learning or problem solving, and typically it may be described by these two components, knowledge about cognition and the regulation of cognition. John Flavel say that metacognition is a higher level order cognition, which is labeled by this prefix of meta to describe how we use cognition to think and to reflect about our own cognition. In the Neo-Piagetian theories of cognitive development, Demetrius' theory was based on a concept called hypercognition that was related to self-monitoring, self-representation and self-regulation. We can look to metacognition by these three phases: planning, monitoring and evaluation, and the product of these three phases can be viewed as reflection. So these three phases can be applied to how individuals look to their own cognition and how they reflect about the contents of that cognition and reflect about the processes that they use to produce some kind of thoughts, feelings, behaviors from self and other. We can also look to metacognition within these compounds. Mental abilities that involves active control over the process of thinking that is used in learning situations. Metacognitive knowledge, metacognitive regulation, and metacognitive experiences. There are three types of metacognitive awareness when considering metacognitive knowledge: declarative knowledge, which is knowledge about oneself, about ourselves; procedural knowledge, which is knowledge about how to do things, how we use our mental heuristics to behave in a given situation or to apply a given strategy to enhance cognitive learning or school contents, and so forth. And the third, conditional knowledge, knowing when and why to use declarative and procedural knowledge, again, to apply in the specific situation. Metacognitive regulation or regulation of cognition may also contain these three skills: planning, selection of strategies to correct allocation of resources that affect test performance; monitoring, one's awareness of comprehension and task performance. Okay, it's the monitoring, it's the ongoing awareness about the products that we are performing within a different or within a given task. And of course, evaluation or evaluating, appraising the final product to a task and the efficacy that is a result from the performance given in certain tasks. Also, Metacognition may be viewed as a developmental process. It is important to know that metacognition is a human ability that is developed from childhood to adulthood. Also, some authors say that metacognition may follow the cognitive development proposed by Piaget. So let's now see how it unfolds here. Typically, metacognition is developed through early ages. However, we tend to use the concept of metacognition when the children have 5 to 7 years old. However, by the age of 3, children have acquired some awareness of themselves and the others. Also, in the age of 4, they understand others' behavior and understand that their behavior is guided by some inner convictions, or, as you can see here, by some beliefs and desires that may not be the same as the children. Thus, metacognition may follow the 4 steps of cognitive development proposed by Piaget, which is sensorimotor stage, pre-operational stage, concrete operational stage, and formal operational stage. Don't be worried, in the future videos I will describe these cognitive stages one by one for you to know more about how to apply this to human development. Thus, as some constructs are concepts in psychology, there are many overlapping concepts that may be related to metacognition or may be similar to metacognition. So let's look to them right now. One is called theory of mind, one is called social cognition, one is called alexithymia, which may be viewed as a deficit or a difficulty on the awareness about inner and external emotional states. Affect consciousness, which may be related to alexithymia. Mentalization, which is a process that is very similar to metacognition. And also, we can look to metacognition from a neuroscience perspective. Therefore, we can see that metacognition has some identified neuronal basis. So, let's look here. Metacognition involves the regulation of attention, conflict resolution, error correction, and inhibitory and emotional regulation. Thus, we know by neuroscience methods that these processes are mediated by the middle frontal brain sections, the middle frontal brain regions, such as anterior cingulate cortex and orbital frontal cortex. Also, there are some overlap of metacognition with other executive functions because of the overlapping neuronal structures or brain structures that are underlying these kind of processes, such as metacognition may be related to working memory, or also it may be related to executive control or even cognitive inhibition or behavioral inhibition. This is why a frontal lobe has a very important role on the regulation of higher order mental abilities. Frontal lobe is a more developed part of the brain which is proposed to be underlying this kind of higher order neurocognitive processes. So, we can look to metacognition and we can relate metacognition with other areas such as metacognition and education. We can look again to these 3 phases, planning, monitoring, and evaluation, and we can look how these phases may impact the learning process. So, Perkins defined that children may have different learning styles. The first one is tacit learners. The second is aware learners. The third is strategic learners. The fourth is reflective learners. So, I think these 4 styles are very self-explanatory. Again, metacognition may be related to social cognition. Why? Because metacognition also implies the cognitive processing of the mental states, desires, wishes, and behaviors of the others. That's why cognitive psychology and social cognition are very interested in the metacognitive processes. So, combination of social psychology and metacognition is referred to as social cognition, where is described thinking and describing the others' behaviors, others' emotional states, others' attitudes or self-attitudes. Another concept that is used in social cognition is life scripts, which is the number of things that we do that is described in our mind with a script, a framework. Just like I go to one restaurant, I will ask to that person what is the menu for today, and then I sit in the table and then I start to eat. This is an example of a social script. So, also, metacognition and social cognition are implied and are driven to study social perceptions. And also, and finally, social cognition is also focused in cultural beliefs. As a researcher, I am very interested in the topic of metacognition because it can be applied to a psychotherapeutic setting. And I will show to you how it can be conceptualized to be used as a clinical tool or as a clinical target to develop consciousness awareness about our own mental processes. Also, I publish an article that I'll show here to you, and this article is related to a metacognitive self-assessment scale. Don't worry, in the future I will describe this article to you and I'll show you how it can be applied not only also in clinical settings but also in educational settings. Now, this is a part that is very interesting to me because now I will say to you two different clinical models that can be used in clinical settings, and these clinical models are based on a metacognitive model. So they are a little bit different, but they can be very useful to you to understand how you can apply some clinical strategies to enhance metacognitive skills. So let's see the first one. The first one, it's the metacognitive multifunction model that was developed by Semerari and colleagues and regards metacognition as a set of intended functions. The first is to identify and describe mental states regarding self and others based on internal experience and observable behavior. The second level is to reflect and to reasoning about these diverse mental contents such as states of mind. Third, to use the mental information for complex decision making and problem solving, also, and to use this kind of information to cope with inner suffering. Lots of research has studied the application of this model to neuropsychiatric disorders or psychiatric disorders such as schizophrenia, personality disorders, and depression. The other model is the self-regulatory executive function that is developed by Wells. So, self-regulatory executive function is a system that encompasses metacognitive beliefs and the mental modes of the executive function. Typically, this function within all these contents may be called the cognitive attentional syndrome that implies individuals to develop some kind of worry and rumination. Individuals are also focused in threat monitoring and they have different coping behaviors that tend to backfire. So the coping behaviors are not adaptive because they backfire and increase the emotional suffering underlying this cognitive attentional syndrome. Typically is related to social anxiety, generalized anxiety, obsessive compulsive disorder, post-traumatic stress disorder, and depression. So, there are three main psychotherapy schools that are focused in metacognition. One is metacognitive therapy, the other one is metacognitive interpersonal therapy from DiMaggio et al. And the other one is focused on a similar concept, which is mentalization, which is a kind of therapy that is developed from Fonagy and his colleagues, which is called the mentalization-based therapy. Don't worry, these kinds of therapies will be target of future videos. So now, let's just summarize our contents for today. So, metacognition may be viewed as a higher order ability, typically known as thinking about thinking or cognition about cognition. Metacognitive or metacognition has different compounds and components, and it tends to be developed through different cognitive stages. We also saw that the frontal lobe tend to be proposed as the neuronal basis for metacognitive thinking, metacognitive abilities, and it may be overlapped with executive functions. metacognition may be related to social cognition and education, and can be applied within different clinical models. We also saw that metacognition is related to different psychological disorders, and there are different psychotherapies that are focused on promoting some kind of skills based on metacognitive procedures, metacognitive knowledge, and are defined with different metacognitive models. So, it's all for today. Don't forget to see the video description regarding today's theme, to see the books and the manuals that I recommend to you. Also, if you like what I'm doing here, please consider to subscribe, hit the bell for notifications, and leave a comment to express your mind and to express your thoughts. Welcome to Mind Brain Talks, and I hope to see you in the next video. Bye!